But maybe I can start by asking, Jerry, how you define empathy, because these days, many of us are talking about the limits of empathy, for instance. You know, we may say that for writers, empathy is a necessary ingredient for whatever kind of writer you are. But empathy can also be something of a block. So would you like to talk about that a little bit?
Thank you for the question, and I'd like to thank the organizers for having me here, and all of you Hyderabadis for turning out. It's my first time in Hyderabad. Be gentle, city of rocks. That must not be photographed, I think. There's a little notice in the campus here, please don't photograph the rocks. And I think that may be because we're trying to have empathy with rocks. You know, you might take their photographs and use them in places where they don't want to be used. And then the rocks
may be poached.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, that way, I see. But it'd be very difficult to poach a rock. No? I mean, imagine trying to take that off the campus without anyone noticing. But anyway, I'm sure. Okay. To begin with, really, the equipment of a writer starts with curiosity. It's curiosity that is directed generally at the lowest and most fundamental level at the world around you. You look at people and you ask yourself, why are they doing what they are doing all the time? So I remember I used to sit in restaurants and I would look at a couple, you know, like four people at a table across us. And the woman would be sitting there saying, middle-aged woman, saying, no, I don't feel hungry. And the man in front of her would be saying, no, you must eat. And then the man would order something and the woman would eat from his plate. And the other two people would be ordering lavishly, and I would be figuring, that man is paying the bill. That is his family. They can order because they are not paying the bill. His wife is thinking, his family comes here and eats all the time, and we get to pay the bill, so I'm not adding to this bill, so I won't eat, but I'll eat from his plate. And this lovely dynamic of who's paying is a story that's unfurling in my head. So whenever and you travel in, the wonderful thing about India, I think, is that, you know, you don't have to actually go out and look for stories. They are thrown at you, literally hurled at you in buses, on trains. I remember sitting down once in a long distance train and asking an old man, what happened, uncle? Because his leg was bandaged. And he said, do you want to see? And he opened the bandage out, okay? Then he showed me the cut on the operation scar, and he pressed it and he said, see, still it is oozing. And this was long before that term, too much information, was invented. But I am the only person in the world who has never used it to anybody. I do not believe there is too much information to be given to a writer. I want more, in fact. So curiosity is, curiosity is also parasitical, because it is absorbent and it is something that takes from you. And I want to take that story and that pus that is coming out of that wound, and I want to use it in my next story. Empathy is the ability to say this man has a wound, and that wound is something he wants to share because he doesn't have anybody to talk about it right now. And can we create a space in which we talk about the wound, and can we create a space in which we help him bandage the wound again, and we don't go and wash our fingers immediately, though we want very much to. Yeah, I am very often, I think, the curious writer rather than the empathetic writer. I would like to be the empathetic writer. When I sit down to write, I can create the illusion of empathy because words are wonderfully malleable and they allow me to create that empathy. But I have, at the base of it, is also the fundamental parasitical, absorbent desire to take everything I can from any human experience. So when I see Chinmay Tumbe, I want to know what it's like to look like a completely dependable 15-year-old boy while being an IIM professor and having two children. You know, like, how do you figure that? How does that happen? You know, or when I'm looking at Shanta and I'm thinking, you know, how does she put together this, the elegance, the poise, the grace, and the sense of humor, the self-deprecating irony. And then the next level of that is, what can I take out of that and use? Okay? So every writer who is in your space, is actually trying his or her best to decode you and then to take what he or she has decoded and turn it into the next story. The problem is most of you are not going to work because there has to be that peculiar logic in which there is the deep well of humanity, which is irrational. Most of what we do is irrational. It is simply driven by some old moments of pain and hurt and fear and love and joy and delight. That's why you make the choices you make. That's why none of your friends like the person you're dating. Because they say, why him? But he smells like the way someone smelled sometime in the past. And that's what fascinates you, right? But in the logic of the novel, I must take your irrationality and on the top of it, I must layer a veneer of rationality. Because otherwise people will say, why is this happening? It's horrible. You see one reality, not horrible. Jerry, stop it. It's difficult. It's challenging. It's lovely. It's fun also. Because you see one reality, you acknowledge one reality, and you write one reality. And then you have to try and bring this reality as close to that reality as possible in only in the illusory sense of language. Only there.
So actually just taking on from this idea of language, you've talked in previous interviews about how, you know, how difficult or poor a tool language is really to describe experience or to describe reality. And I think what you said is, you know, the same language or the same words that we use to order chicken manchuria have to be used to describe something transcendental or something really important. So how does one then deal with this imperfect tool and turn it into something beautiful or something that is experienced as beauty?
You know, I'm glad you used the word transcendental. The first time I heard the word transcendental, I must have been about like 7 years old. And I really thought it was something medical. Because I thought it was about dental. So transcendental, I thought it must be something like you go, because I knew a little bit about, you know, like I think someone had told, we had an ashtray called TWA, Trans World Airlines. And my father, who explained everything as painfully as possible, would say, what does trans mean? And you say, I don't know. And he'd say, what do you know? Trans means across. So I thought it was across your teeth, something about across your teeth. And this word which ends in dental is supposed to describe the most beautiful, most transcendental moments that we have. Right? How does that even figure? So a lot of the language that, I was a very lazy sort of reader. So when I read books, I just wanted to know more. I just wanted to read on. What I should have done is put down the book and looked up transcendental. Put down the book and looked up polenta. Put down the book and looked at a dictionary. Instead of which, I was guessing madly. And often language played this game with me. Sometimes, you know, it was right. And then you're encouraged not to check that dictionary anymore. And sometimes you were so badly wrong. Transcendental is not about medical technology that you thought, okay, maybe next time I'll check the dictionary. You know. But so I don't think anything that I say about language is terribly original. You know, like I was reading Walter Benjamin or something that you weren't supposed to say his name.
Benjamin. You said his name right the last time.
Yeah? Okay, I said it right, Walter Benjamin. Okay. He said that if you actually had to have a word to describe every single emotion that every single human being felt in degree and in quantity, in shape, in nuance, in texture, the dictionary would be larger than the universe. So what you are going to do is work within the constraints of the language. And sometimes when you're feeling brave, when you're feeling the possibility of language under you, you make a word. And that is so lovely. Like recently I was writing and, you know, I was thinking about this young man who wants to buy, when it's like revealing the next novel. But this young man has been brought up with langots, and he wants to buy VIP underwear. You know, it is just his desire to actually wear VIP underwear because he thinks that will make him sexually attractive, it will make him modern, it will fit him in with society around him, and he's wearing langots. And he's washing his langot and he's hanging it out and he calls it a ragment of his old life. Fragment, ragment. I thought it was so lovely. Everyone who reads it says there's a typo on page 7, it's fragment. I'm thinking, but get it, yeah, it's a new word, no. But they say, so I have now put that F in. But that F is a very delicate, tenuous F. It may blow off at any moment. It may disappear at any moment, but and then I will have my ragment. But there is also an editor to confront with and whatnot. So I think, you know, one of the things that I have discovered is that I'm chai. Thank you. Are you mad? This is India. Chai without sugar is not chai. Anyway, I think I've discovered that I enjoy working with language. I even enjoy being battered down when people say, Jerry, that's sentimental. I have very, very good friends. Naresh is here, Shanta, Arundhati, Ranjit. I am blessed with friends who are severely critical. And therefore, they will puncture my balloons. So I produce fuggas all the time. And I will get, Naresh rang up and said this when he read my first novel, M and the Big Home. He said such a terrifying thing. He said, Pinto, fiction is about tension and the release of tension, right? What's the tension release in your book? I thought, oh, mother of God. Oh, stabat mater, I thought, deploying whatever Latin I had. And I stayed up all night thinking, how do I get tension and lack of tension into the book? I didn't eventually, but it was something that I thought about. And then I figured that I'd actually done it without knowing it with the death of M at the end of the book. But I'm saying, writing is not, and language, okay, the notion of language is that it is a cooperative endeavor, right? If I say chair and you think table, then we're finished. Therefore, the creation of language has also got to be a cooperative endeavor. The creation of a book has to be a cooperative endeavor. And I write with a village. It takes a village for me to write a book.
Yeah, in fact, I think, again, you know, I'm trying hard to not make this conversation, reminiscent of every other conversation you've had with every other person. But
I also am trying very hard.
Yeah, so, talking about, you did mention M and the Big Home and the fact that there is no, in your mind, or at that point, Naresh Fernandez did not see a release in it. But in a sense, you know, those who read the book and those many of you have read the book, I think there is a release, yet there is a sense in which the book continues to stay within you. Because I think you said somewhere that all of us are not 6 degrees separated from, but 1 degree separated from somebody with a mental illness. So how does one, you know, trying to talk, going back to the question of language, language is your tool to, in a way, bring to life this experience that is perhaps in some ways universal. But at the same time, in order to do that, you have to also create something beautiful, right? Out of an experience which is not necessarily beautiful. So how does one, isn't there also this seductive power of language to turn something that is extremely difficult and extremely sometimes painful and all the other adjectives you might use into something beautiful so that you generate empathy? I don't know, am I?
No, don't worry. We're all feeling our way. I understand that the quality in the question is also like the texture of the question. So don't worry about that. I think sometimes, you know, I think I'm a modernist in my head. I mean, not that one ever thinks I am a modernist, but you think, I want this to work rather than I want it to be beautiful. Okay? And what is the work then? The question then becomes, what is the work that you want to do? I want the book to be what a book has meant, what books have meant to me. which is life breath. I can imagine very darkly a world without books, but I do think it was life breath. I think it's really, really important. I think it's fundamentally important. So when people say, you know, I was reading this book and I thought, oh, I can write like that. And I think, no. You shouldn't like read a bad book and think, then I can write, I can also write. You should read a really great book and think, I want to write like that. I want to be that really great book. I want to be that next book. And okay, yeah, every time I settle down to write, I want to produce a masterpiece. Okay, most of the time I don't. 98% of the time I don't. Sometimes I write something that I think is a masterpiece, something that I think is beautiful, truly beautiful. And I see it the next morning and I think, really, Jerry? Really? This purple prose? And then it dies and, you know, you can edit it, throw it away. The problem is trying to, actually, there is a self that is deeply self-critical. There is a self that is deeply self-hating. There is a self that is deeply self-valorizing. These three are in a constant struggle with each other. I want someday to put that self-hating to rest. I want to be able to say, like, you know, this is it. This is what you did. Look at it. Look at it the way you'd look at Usha's book, if Usha wrote a book. Be sympathetic, but accept the book on its own terms, and then say what you think. And because it's me, it's not Usha, I don't owe an empathy debt. I should owe myself an empathy debt as well. But I don't. I don't seem to. So I can be savagely critical of my own work and kill thousands and thousands, like, easily. I mean, for every novel or book that I've written 6 books that I've killed. Before my first translation came out, I did 6 translations which I did not want anybody to see because they were so bad. So I sometimes wonder whether this is just the way it is. You know, it's like there are those three snakes which are all sort of wrapped around each other, and from their churning some amrita is produced, or whether I'm just doing it all wrong and it'll all fall apart. This is, I think, the terror of every writer, that in situations like this, you are asked, what is your process? You invent a process, and then you must take that story back and you must deconstruct it again, because your process is not like that the next day. Your process has changed. So as honest as you can be about process, you feel you're being dishonest, because tomorrow it won't be like that. I'm not even sure if I've answered your question, but...
You've answered a question.
Okay, done. This is a very good way to say it. Yeah. What was the question again? Let's try and see if I can get it. A beauty. Was that beauty?
Yes.
Okay, so it was beauty.
Maybe I can help you there a little bit, because I was reading this thing about, from K. Jameson, who writes about mental illness as well. And
Unquiet
she says,
Mind. What a book.
Yes, yeah. Unquiet Mind and Touched by Fire. And she talks about the fact that it's a Chinese proverb that she's paraphrasing. And she says, in order to defeat a beast or defeat something, you have to make it beautiful. And I thought there was something there that connected with this idea of drawing on an experience that is painful, but also joyous. How does one turn it into, you know, where does beauty come in there in relation to language?
Okay, I think for me, when I read a passage that is overtly beautiful, I'm generally sickened. I'm immediately kind of like almost turned off. So when I read... I think, let's say, Ronald Furbank, for instance, who is deliberately trying to be beautiful. I can see what the project is, and I can see where someone might want to do this, and it is not my project. It is not my project. My project is something else, at any rate. Beauty is not part of this thing. Beauty is an accident of the connection that I make with my reader. So between me and the reader and the book in between, beauty sparks into being in that moment of reading. But in the writing of it, I try to be as factual, and if any beauty manages to slip in, it is not the beauty of construction, but the beauty of
meaning, maybe?
Of what is the word for it when you place things next to each other?
Juxtaposition.
That's another horrible dirty word. Juxtaposition. Like everything. Cursor. What kind of like sound is that? Juxt. Juxt what? Juxtaposition. No, the juxtaposition that I take once in a while. Rubbish word. But anyway, juxtaposition is beauty comes out of juxtaposition, but three juxtapositions. One, my intention. Second, my writing. Third, your reading, your sympathetic reading. It only comes out of those three things for me. For other people, they can produce signally and significantly beautiful things. I just feel slightly odd.
Okay, just read a very short passage from your book. Maybe not okay. M, but from Murder in My Head.
No. Chalo, even.
I saw a lot of empathy there.
No.
I know this is like completely way off, but we talked about purple prose. Mm. And please note that the pages are edged in purple. But the prose is not purple.
If there was one thing I feared as I was growing up, no, that's stupid. I feared hundreds of things. The dark, the death of my father, the possibility that I might rejoice at the death of my mother, sums involving vernier calipers, groups of schoolboys with nothing much to do, death by drowning. But of all these, I feared most the possibility that I might go mad too. If that happened, my only asset would be taken from me. Growing up, I knew I did not have many advantages. I had no social skills. I had no friends. I had no home, no home that was a refuge. I seemed to have no control over my body. My clumsiness was legendary. All I had was my mind, and this was at peril from my genes. Em's manic state was often rude and ugly, but that's how I remember her, as a rough, rude, roistering woman. In this state, she came at us as an equal, but it was the other Em who was my night terror. As if it were a wild animal with flecks of foam at its mouth, I feared her depression. I found it hard to reconcile the way that word felt to the state my mother was in when she was dragged down into the subterranean depths of her soul. Depression seems to suggest a state that could be dealt with by ordinary means, by a comedy on the television, or an extravagance at a nice shop. It suggested a dip in level ground where you might stumble, but from which you might scramble, a little embarrassed that it should have caught you unawares, a little red-faced from the exertion, but otherwise unharmed. Em's depressions were not like that. Imagine you are walking in a pleasant meadow with someone you love, your mother. It's warm, and there's just enough of a breeze to cool you. You can smell earth and cut grass and something of a herb garden. Lunch is a happy memory in your stomach, and dinner awaits you. All your comfort foods. The light is golden with a hint of blue, as if the sky were leaking. Suddenly, your mother steps into a patch of quicksand. The world continues to be idyllic and inviting for you, but your mother is being sucked into the depths of the earth. She makes it worse by smiling bravely, by telling you to go on, to leave her there. She is the man with the broken leg on the Arctic expedition who says, "Come back for me. It's my best chance." Because then he knows that he is allowing everyone to believe they are not letting him die. Some part of you walks on, and some part of you stays there, frozen, watching the spectacle. You want to stay, but you must go. The imperium of the world's timetable will allow you to break step and fall out for a while, but it will abandon you. It will abandon you too if you linger too long by your mother. Now a curled up fetal ball, moaning in pain, breathing only because her body forces her to. The only way to deal with this pain is to blot it out. My mother is now in a state where her mind tortures her. It will not even let her sag into apathy. Sometimes I see her body twitching a little in pain. Sometimes I see her forcing herself into a rigid stillness. Nothing will help her answer whatever savage questions are going through her mind. Kill me, she says on days when the pain is so bad that she is panting with it small, barely audible sobs. Let me die. I don't know how to respond. I want to kill her. I even know how I will do it. First, some very strong drugs of which there is a readily available supply. Then when she is sleeping, her breath stertorous, a pillow. I run it as a thought experiment. Just as I run the what will I do if my father dies experiment. I don't think I will ever be able to hold her down if she flails. So I'm hoping the drugs will make her quiescent. But I also know that I will not do it. I wonder if she knows this too, and this is why she asks. I will not do this because I know that she is coming up now. This is the worst of it, and it can only be a couple of days now before she begins to surface. These will be the days when the big home will sit by her bed, and she will hold his forearm as he reads the paper. From time to time, she will say, Mambo, and he will put down the paper and look at her. Only look at her. Nothing, she will say. And then he will begin to read again.
But I wanted to also segue into the book of essays that you edited and brought together, A Book of Light, which in many...
Oh, please buy The Book of Light. It is such a brave book.
It is, yes. Endorse that completely. But in that, in the foreword to that, you talk about the fact that you know, many of these stories cut really close to the bone, and so you recognize how difficult they are to tell. But in a way, the telling of them is in itself an act of healing or an act of, I don't know about catharsis, but it's definitely something that helps in some way. So what has been the, you know, after the publication of A Book of Light, did you get many more people writing in who hadn't actually contributed to the book?
There are people who write in practically every week saying, I'd like to contribute an essay, I'd like to do something. And I always say, yes, please, but the first step is to actually write your essay. You know, then the next thing is, can you assure me that it will be published? Which I can't. Even through the course of, the reason why the Book of Light was something that was so difficult. I mean, not, okay. Okay, here's the thing. It started because when I would do readings from M in the Big Home, suddenly it became as if readings became encounter groups, people telling their stories, you know, saying, I locked my brother in a room for 5 years because he was hearing from God, and then we discovered that it was a psychiatric problem. But we took 5 years from his life, can you imagine? Energy was being released, emotion was being released, and I had no way of controlling or helping with it because I'm not a trained mental health professional. I'm not. So a friend of mine suggested you must tell them to write. So we started with the idea that people who were suffering from or who had dealt with being neurodivergent or having a mental illness would write. And then other people wanted to write who had dealt with their friends and family having the problem. And eventually it became just the friends and family because the people who were dealing with it just didn't produce the writing. That was fine. I respected their silences. But even these, you've just written me an essay where you're saying, I walked into the room and my daughter was dead. She had killed herself. And I am going to write back to you, and I'm going to say, yes, thank you for this beautiful and wonderful essay, but now let's look at how we can make it more powerful, how we can make it into a good piece of writing. I hated myself as I wrote each of those emails. And I wrote an email like that every other day for a year, telling people, do this, see that, open this out, tell me more about this, fill up that part, explain this, make this logical, give me the sense of that. You're telling this about someone's daughter's suicide, you fuckhead, I kept saying to myself. Be gentler. And I don't know how to be gentle. I'm trying. I would like work on those emails as if they were my prose. They were not. But I don't, I mean, I may have hurt people. I apologize right now if I did. But everyone came through brilliantly. They all did their edits. They came through and they sent it in. And the Book of Light came out. And I still think that is a powerful book. And it also gave rise to another, you know, in the sense I always say books should give rise to books. That books, you know, like when someone comes up to me and says, you know, M in the Big Home is is my story and my mother's story, and you know, I wanted to write it. I said, don't not write your story. Your story has a place in the world. Your story has its own moment. Your story has its own specificities, and those are deeply, deeply important, but you've got to write those stories. You've got to write the story down for it to matter, okay? Or at least it may matter to you, but for it to matter to someone else. Because in the act of writing is the act of empathy that we were talking about at the beginning. So most people find when actually confronted with the moment when you have to start writing, if you are not a writer, they discover that it is really hard work. You have to put one word down, then you have to put another word down, then you have to put a third word down, you have to put a fourth word down, and you have to go on and on and on, and often you think you've written so much and you check your word count and it's 225 words. And you think like, really? I wrote all hour for an hour and it's 225 words. But hey, that happens. Then I often also remind people, writing is like being a mason. You put a brick, you put a brick, you put a brick. But a mason, at the end of putting all those bricks, hangs his plumb line. The plumb line is accurate. The wall is good. You can sit back and say, I have done my job. I'm a good mason. No writer has that satisfaction. No writer has that satisfaction. You are a good writer only for the moment that you have finished that work and it is glowing, fresh born, covered with your own juices. It is so gorgeous as that line. And then someone reads it and says, you know, dangling participle. What have you done? Another person says, Jerry Pinto fancies himself a humorous writer. You know, people just savage your work. Time savages your work. The canon savages your work. People don't read you. All kinds of things are possible. So you will never hang your plumb line on that sentence and think, I've done a good job. I can go home now and have a drink. You will always live with a negotiation between I did my best. Please, 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 I did my best. And how the fuck can't you see it's a great book? And yeah, you're right. I could have done it better. All these three are rattling about in your head at every moment of the day. And you still want me to come up here and produce a coherent dialogue about the process of writing. Lokal lobat.
Did anyone ask you about the process of writing?
No, didn't, actually. But gum firake sneaky sneaky Usha Raman, that is what you have been doing. Okay, yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
You should open the questions.
Yes, now we have to open it up.
Kalpana Mohan over there in the front row. And then there is someone in the row, I think Anjali, no?
Am I not supposed to do
Oh, yes. Keeping to the subject of empathy, how do I bring up empathy towards a nasty reviewer?
Oh, okay. My response to nasty reviewers is to go up to them and be very kind. Go up and say, hi, how are you? I've missed you. Where have you been? One, it puzzles the fucks. Okay, like completely. They don't know why you're so friendly. Second, it is telling them, yes, you savaged my book. Okay? But I don't care. I'm still smiling at you. I love you to death. Because your review was so inconsequential that I can still be friendly. Yeah. So be very, very kind to the nasty reviewer. Who is, by the way, feeling guilty. We've also been nasty reviewers. We're feeling guilty at when you see it in print, you think, oh, God. Yeah? Now you want to retract it or just, you know, send the book back and say, this is not something I want to talk about. Now that's what I do. I just send the book back and say, it's not something I want to talk about. Because that time when you took pride in writing gorgeous lines like that New York Times dick wipe, I mean, that's gone now. You don't feel that gentle, that happy savagery anymore. Yeah? So empathy to a bad reviewer, love them. I'm very Christian.
How does the difference between a curious writer and an empathetic writer show up on paper?
The curious writer is, okay, this morning, for my diaries, for instance, I write a diary, I write a therapeutic diary, I write an event diary, I write a to-do diary, but every day I write down a writer's diary. which is, what did I do as a writer? Who are the writers and editors and people of significance whom I met? All the things that they said to me, all the possibilities. So I write about for 1 hour every day. I just write down everything so that I've got it somewhere. Okay? And I hold on to that diary. Now, that diary is just my attempt to say, Shanta Gokhale said this morning, Naresh Fernandez said this morning. People, Usha Raman asked me this question. All that will be down somewhere. Okay? That's just me being the sponge. Okay? And also building a certain archive against amnesia. Okay? That's one level. So I have about 230 diaries like that. Yeah? One day that is all going to be the material for the junkyard. Okay? But those are things that I've... Now, when that's raw material, no one will ever see it in my lifetime. Now, when I'm looking at that sometimes, there are things that I can draw out and I can move here. This movement from here to here is a movement of hypocrisy. In this movement, I am not aware of anyone reading that stuff. In this movement, I am now aware of the outside eyes. And here, I will now don the robes of the empath. And I will create an empathetic space. Empathy is not natural. Empathy is earned. Empathy, you have to insist, because you can be empathetic to your own kind, right? Shanta feels pain, I will be empathetic immediately. Naresh feels pain, Ranjit, Arundhati, all my friends. But what about my enemies? If empathy has a meaning, it must be empathy when you do not feel the need, feel empathetic at all. That is empathy, right? And to do that requires an effort of will. You have to say, I will try empathy today. To the reviewer who's been nasty to you, is an effort of will, because what you want to do is pound them into the ground. Beat the shit out of them. But you will not. You will smile. That's a choice that you make. It's a hypocritical choice of young people. All those young people will be there, be saying, see, he's over 30, you can't trust him now. He's telling you to lie. But most of the things that make us human, truly human or humane even, are things that we have to teach ourselves to do. You teach yourself to be empathetic.